Well, hello, I'm Blue Plunkett and welcome back to SciGest. Today we're trying a bit of a new format for us, a session we're calling the SciFri Sessions, bit of a tongue twister, lost it already. And so this is where a group of us are going to meet up on Friday afternoons to discuss science, and we each bring a news story we found during the week that we can share and have a little chat about, and then we pick a topic to go in more depth discussion around. So we're going to try and pick topics that cover some interesting ground and brush up against some contentious issues and perhaps even find some disagreement between the panelists. So today the topic we've chosen is what is natural. So before we dive into that, I'll just introduce our panel. So joining me, we have Jay, Tom, and Andrew. So if we just go around, Jay, if you put your beer down for a second.
That's pretty tough, but okay. Hi, I'm Jay. I'm a plant scientist working on bacterial diseases of kiwi fruit.
I'm Tom Saunders. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Auckland. I'm based at Planet Food, and I'm looking at biological control.
Hi, I'm Andrew. I work on flavonoids and apple. I'm a last-minute replacement for Jess, who's watching in the background because she's got a cold. So, yeah, hopefully they're doing an okay job.
Right, so that's our panel for today, and so we're all researchers currently at Plant and Food Research at various stages in our careers representing entomological, molecular, biochemical, and pathogen expertise. So the way I figure it is together we might be able to approximate one valid opinion about what is natural.
Or perhaps not.
Yeah, or maybe not at all. So thanks everybody for joining us today, and I guess, Jade, did you bring us a news story today?
Yeah, I actually got a couple of news stories that I think are kind of linked. So I grabbed these off of Science Daily, which trolls through recent publications of science papers. And the papers I'm looking at from Science Daily is they talk about how plants have the way they breathe as well as the way they sneeze. So interestingly, the way that plants acquire oxygen from the atmosphere and release CO2, the structure of the leaves, it looks like human lungs, in fact. And humans have been sort of training these plants to have smaller and smaller lungs over time. And I just thought that it was interesting that there are these things that plants do that we're not aware of, and they're so animal-like. And also the second story is where plants have droplets with bacteria or fungi that fall on them. And through electrostatic forces and a hydrophobic surfaces that repel water, they're able to eject these droplets right off. It's kind of like the way we sneeze.
So, Jay, why would plants want smaller lungs? What's the idea behind that? Why are we breeding them for smaller lungs?
Actually, that's a good question. The weird thing about this is that the plants don't want the smaller lungs. We do. So when these plants have so-called smaller lungs, they have smaller leaf spaces, air spaces in the leaves, sorry. As a result, they tend to be drought resistant. So when you select for drought resistance, you're selecting for plants with effectively smaller lungs. And this can have side effects, right?
Yeah, because you'd think that if you had less gas going in there to turn into, you know, photosynthesis and stuff, then you're going to have a less effective plant, maybe?
Absolutely. I think that's one of the things that they're worried about, and they're trying to look at that right now.
Maybe they get smaller but up the number, maybe.
Yeah, interesting.
And it reduces respiration, I don't know. But so when they said that it was like lungs, does it actually look like lungs? Or because we know that there's little pores on the leaf that let in air in and out. But was there something new that they found that reminded them of lungs in the particular story?
Yeah, so in that paper, so those pores you're talking about, they're called stomata. And so what happens with these leaves is if you increase the number of stomata, the amount of space that's in the leaf automatically increases. So it's almost as if the number of holes in the leaf determines how much space is inside the leaf.
Right.
And so if you're selecting for something like drought tolerance, you're selecting for less holes in the leaf, less stomata, and therefore selecting for less space in the leaf and less gas exchange.
That sounds pretty interesting in the context of changing climate and things like that. It could become important to have more drought-tolerant plants, so that's quite a cool story.
And the second story, where plants sneeze, I found that really interesting because we don't think of plants sneezing, but there are quite a few examples of how, you know, plants can behave something like animals or like humans.
So does it build up a pressure and push air out to push the bacteria away, or did it not say to that level?
No. Actually, it's not something the plant really has control over. So the droplets kind of merge together based on the physics of the molecules of the water droplets themselves. But what the plant does is it has a really hydrophobic, a really water repellent surface. And that really allows the droplets to do this. So when they sort of stick together violently, that force is then used to eject them off the surface of the leaf. So that's great for the plant that's doing the sneezing, but it's really terrible for the other plants around it. The bacteria and stuff get ejected onto other guys.
So how far do the droplets go?
They actually get picked up by the wind. So you can imagine how far they go.
Like an aerosol.
So they kind of hop up a little bit, and then the wind catches them and shifts them onto the next plant. And there could be bacteria or spores from fungi in there, which is bad news, I guess, if you're...
Maybe good for the bacteria that the plants are sneezing them off and spreading them around.
Just like us, during flu season.
Yeah.
Cover your mouth.
Cool story. So, Tom, did you bring a story also?
Did you do your homework, Tom?
I always do my homework. So what I found quite interesting this week was the story on Vox.com about a Twitter account run by a guy who is kind of a little bit frustrated at some of the media stories that come out about medicine and things like that, where results in mice are portrayed as though they're results in human beings, with all the sort of implications that come with that. And so the Twitter account is called Just Says in Mice. And what it does is it just kind of retweets or links a story that's making some claim about something going on in people, and then just says in mice to draw attention to the fact that this is actually not in human beings, it's just in mice.
Right, so they're like pushing the results a bit far because mice are used for the mammalian model, but just because it works in mice doesn't mean it's going to work in humans, right?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. That's sort of the idea. And I kind of like that sort of stuff because I'm quite interested in, you know, how science is portrayed in the media and how it's used to make decisions and all that kind of thing.
Yeah, that's an interesting sort of like self-correcting mechanism where they've made this Twitter thing to point out that you don't want to overstep
your
results. So that's,
I think it's a mixture of sort of press releases embellishing things a little bit or not quite mentioning the details, but also sometimes the researchers themselves, when they're interviewed, they might forget to say that it's just a mouse model, but then it's also sort of, you know, the sort of clickbaity headlines want to sound, you know, like this thing has happened, it affects you, but maybe it's just kind of in mice at the moment. So
is that a fair criticism though? Because a lot of trials are done in mice and some are quite predictive of human biology and others aren't, so it probably depends on what you're looking at, really.
I mean, there was one I remember, and it was basically, the headline was basically, if you eat McDonald's fries, you'll grow your hair back.
And, right.
And I mean, it's kind of like, there was something about in mice how the oils or something to do with the you know, like, something to do with the fries.
The poor mice that they made lose all their hair.
Yeah, that's what
place.
I was thinking. That's what I was thinking.
The McDonald's.
Yeah. So it's kind of a big jump to be making those kinds of claims, I think. That's,
so what you're saying is I need to be eating more fries.
Absolutely.
Jay does not need an excuse.
Yeah. You don't fries. Even need the Twitter feed to remind you there's a direct correlation.
Right. So. Excellent. This is good news.
Good news science. That's what we're about. Yeah.
But it's only like hair on your tail or something. So...
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what.
Yeah, I wouldn't think a mouse model would be very good for human hair loss.
Yeah, I don't think so. No, I don't. Yeah.
Imagine the biology of hair growth in people and mice is
quite different.
Quite different. Yeah.
Yeah.
So fair enough. Yeah, that's pretty good. Cool.
You're quite a quick, short notice stand-in, Andrew. So I don't know if you had time to find anything in the news, or did you happen to come across anything?
My dog ate my homework. Yeah. My toddler ate my homework. Yeah, I had a quick look this morning, as I do, 5 minutes before I got here, whatever it was.
You prepared?
I wouldn't call it prepared. Prepared's too kind a word for this. Just reminded me from what Jay was saying about the sneezing with the plants, because as I mentioned before, Jessica's had a cold, I've had a cold, we all share the same open plan office. So I was just interested in looking at like cold biology and how that works and cold viruses, and years ago, people promised us a cure for the cold or a vaccine for the cold. And I was just looking at why hasn't that happened? And it's what I thought was the answer, which is basically there are so many different kinds of cold virus. There are 160 different what they call serotypes, which is how they classify the different viruses. So very hard to build a vaccine that targets all of them. Although some groups overseas are now compiling these vaccines together, so to cover as many of these different types of viruses as possible. So there is work being done. And that kind of led me down the road of the flu virus, because it's flu season at the moment as well. So everyone's kind of getting hit by that. And there was an interesting article, I'm not sure where I read it actually, it might have been New Idea, one of the leading science
one
periodicals.
One of your normal science journals.
Women's Weekly, yeah. It's a university researcher at Flinders in Sydney, Australia. And they're using AI, artificial intelligence, to model vaccines for the flu virus. So they're trying to build like a turbocharged flu vaccine, because the flu vaccine's based on the previous year's flu viruses, and it's very predictive, and quite often they get it right, but quite often they also get it wrong.
Do you know what they target? Is it like proteins on the virus?
Yeah, so a lot of flu viruses are made from proteins that the virus has on its coat, and that's what they're using. So they don't often use live virus to vaccinate you, but I think that varies from year to year. So what they're doing is they're engineering something called an adjuvant. An adjuvant is something they add to the vaccine to boost your immune response. And they can work by boosting your immune cells, by recruiting them to the site of the injection. They can also work by slowly releasing the viral particles that are in the vaccine slowly into your bloodstream over time, so your body has a chance to build up the immune response. So they're a useful thing that people have been adding to vaccines for a long time. And it's often what the anti-vaxxers object to, incidentally. It's the adjuvants that people put in the vaccines.
To recruit the immune system, like prime it.
You don't get a very good response without it, is basically how it works. So these guys got a whole lot of adjuvants that people had tried before that worked, and a whole lot that didn't work. And they taught the computer basically which ones worked and which ones didn't work, and got the computer designed through AI a new adjuvant or predict adjuvants that will work. So they did this, and it crunched up the numbers, and they designed, it was basically an entire new synthetic molecule, and they incorporated it into their vaccine. And they're now doing trials in the US, but initial results are showing that it's showing a much better immune response. So it's a whole different approach to designing new drugs by getting the computer to try and work out what's a good drug. Because for us, it's really hard to, when you look at the list of the things that they use for adjuvants, they're all completely different kinds of molecules. There's nothing kind of similar about them. So I don't know what the computer is recognizing to build a new one, but it's pretty clever technology if it works.
Yeah, well, that's pretty cool. And it's interesting that it has an additive effect to the dead virus particle that was triggering our immune system in like traditional vaccinations, I guess. So maybe one day in the future, we won't even need the virus particle because the adjuvants or something will work so well that
I think that you still need the virus part to make it specific, because the adjuvant will just raise a general immune reaction. It's not the shingles virus.
So does this mean that we get to go to 2 yearly vaccines?
Yeah, because they're yearly, aren't they, for the flu virus?
Slow release, like he was saying.
Yeah, the adjuvants are slow release, but whether or not the actual your antibody response would last long enough. And I guess the trouble is the specific part of the virus will keep changing year to year as the viral strains. This is just a way of what they're doing is making the virus, the vaccine kind of turbocharged and really, so you get a really strong immune reaction. You know, when you get flu virus, you always get like maybe an itchy arm or an inflamed arm. Mm-hmm. That's generally due to the adjuvants they're putting in, the other chemicals they're putting in to cause that irritation.
From the vaccine.
Yeah, right, yeah. Right. And it's often why you feel a bit crook afterwards. If you feel like you've got a temperature or a bit fluey, that's not really the live...
It's not the virus.
It's not the virus adjuvant. They put in your eyes. It's the adjuvant.
So. Yeah, that's cool. I had no idea about that, but it's cool to hear about the progress in vaccines.
Yeah, sorry.
I'd always wondered, because they typically use dead viral particles and the proteins on them, I'd always wondered if there's something more fundamental about the virus we could target with the vaccination so that it wouldn't change year to year, like how they seem to be able to evolve around the vaccines.
Yeah, that's what they're trying to do, I think, with the cold virus. And I think they've targeted something that they use to wrap around their DNA to protect it. So the virus produces this particular...
Something primary for
that. Something pretty that they all share. So you can knock that out and knock out all the viruses in one go. So I think that's what they're doing with the cold virus.
Right, very cool.
Well, if you ask my mom, she'll just say, just stay out of the cold, you won't get sick.
It doesn't work, I think. I know.
I'm pretty sure viruses don't care whether it's cold or not.
Does the cold bring on a cold? Yeah.
All right, final story that I found, and it's about as different again. It was published on the 28th of June this year, 2019, and on sciencenews.org. And it was by a French research team who seemed to have finally managed to compress hydrogen enough to turn it into a solid. And they found that it's a metal. So they hadn't really shown that before. So because hydrogen is normally a gas and you have to cool it down to 20 degrees above absolute zero, which is negative 250 degrees Celsius, before it turns into a liquid. And then you have to go even cooler before it turns into a solid. But you can also get it to turn into a solid by putting it under pressure. So that's how this team in France did it. And so there's this interesting relationship between like pressure and temperature. And I suppose the easiest way to understand it is how like where water boils. So if you're on the top of Mount Everest, water will boil at a cooler temperature at 70 degrees or something like that compared to 100 degrees at sea level. And so to get the hydrogen to turn into a solid, they had to bring it up to over 4 million atmospheres of pressure.
What is 4 million atmospheres?
That sounds like a lot.
It's a ridiculous, it's quite hard to wrap your head around. I got some numbers here. So it's 58 million PSI. And so one atmosphere, which is pretty much what we are feeling now, is 14 PSI. And so that gives you some type of idea. And so the way they do it is they have these like two, it's called a diamond anvil. And they do it with diamonds because diamonds are hard enough, and they just crush the hydrogen between this diamond anvil to get to such high pressure. And so I thought that was pretty interesting.
I thought we already knew that it would be a metal based on where it is in the periodic table.
I think it was theorized that it would be a metal, but no one had managed to turn it into a solid yet. Because
it's on the left-hand bit, isn't it? I'm trying to remember what the periodic table is.
Yeah, it's number one.
Just above sodium, lithium. Just above lithium.
Do you just want to sing lithium, the song for me and I can remember what comes next?
And it's quite interesting that it's the most common form of matter, and we hadn't even managed to turn it into a solid yet. And the interesting thing about it being a metal is it's got interesting properties. So they think it's going to be a superconductor, which means it has zero electrical resistance, and it'll be a superconductor at room temperature. And also it's metastable, which means once you've pressurized it into a solid, you can release the pressure and it stays solid. So if someone could figure out how to make this well, then it could be a pretty awesome material.
What could you use it for, though?
So superconductors are quite like a holy grail thing to get, I think, because if you can transfer electricity with zero losses, then that makes electricity a lot easier to move around.
Transmission of electricity would be super efficient.
Yeah, transmission of electricity loses like 30% of the usable and just heat and things, I think. So that's quite interesting. So, and then if something's a superconductor, you can start a circuit and it'll just flow forever once the circuit's going. So I don't understand it very well because I'm not much of a physicist, but being a superconductor at room temperature is quite a cool thing. That's about as far as I understand. Okay.
The word super is enough to clue you.
Yeah, like that gives you hints.
It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, there's your clue.
Yeah, so very interesting stories, and cool. Glad we all didn't turn up with the same one, which could have happened, which would have been funny as well.
It's a weird coincidence. There's so much science news out there.
Yeah, cool. So that means we can jump into our main topic for our discussion today, around what is natural. So it's not exactly a small topic, so it should keep us busy. So I didn't know exactly where to start, but I thought I could start off with two things that I initially thought around this topic. Is that when I first looked online, it seems that there's just like a lot of discussion threads like on Reddit and Quora, and largely based around people's opinions. But to actually find something that sort of scientifically discusses it or books about it, you'd have to go quite a bit more in depth. And so then I was wondering who would know the answer to this question if there is one, and it would probably be a philosopher, I thought. Mm. And it would be cool to have a philosopher on one day, but in lieu of that.
We'll get Plato.
Yeah, Plato would be good. So really it's quite opinion-based and it's not really well-defined. I don't know if any of you came across a definition in your musings. Not really.
The definitions I found were always sort of separating humans from nature. So saying something's natural if it's not derived from humans or their activities.
Right.
And that's kind of a really big assumption underpinning what most people think of as natural, I think.
Yeah, I think that's probably the most general way people understand it is existing or derived from nature versus caused by humans, I guess.
But in the broader sense, though, I did find a definition that everything in the universe is technically natural because it's part of the universe.
That's right. Aren't humans derived from nature? Mm. Aren't humans natural? Yeah, so yeah, that's quite a blurry concept to start with.
Do you want the Wikipedia definition?
I'd love that.
Yeah, what does Wikipedia say?
Well, you'd all love that because I got that open at the moment. In philosophy, naturalism is the idea or belief that only natural laws and forces operate in the world as opposed to, I guess,
supernatural,
spiritual or, you know, religious or stuff like that. Supernatural, yeah.
Mm, yeah, so it comes in those sort of forms. So it's like natural versus unnatural or natural versus supernatural. So unnatural maybe is what humans cause, and then there's supernatural, which is like magical and spiritual. Don't know how far we'll get into that.
Yeah, you've obviously got a different angle on it than that.
So why do you think we're so obsessed with natural?
That's a really good point, because people seem to really dislike unnatural and really think that natural is good. And it's because like natural has like wholesome or goodness or well-being sort of associated with it, whereas unnatural seems to, maybe people think like people, we're playing God, or it's not meant to be, or it's artificial or toxic, and there seems to be these connotations associated with.
Right, so what we are saying is anything synthetic, anything man-made is unnatural, but anything that we get from nature, like we mine or we get from plants or animals, is natural?
Yeah, well, I guess that would generally cover it, but then you can get into like confusing things like, so medicine wouldn't be natural because humans are making it, but I think medicine...
What about natural medicine? What about herbalism and things like that?
Oh yeah, true. Well, that type of medicine would be considered natural, I guess. So I guess even medicine has a natural, unnatural dividing line.
Mm. I suppose when you go through clinical trials, your natural medicine becomes unnatural.
Once Big Pharma is associated with it, I think it becomes unnatural.
I think this is really, I think for most people, it sort of just comes down to a gut reaction, whether it's something that's natural or not. And it's not really something you can define. And the other thing that's interesting about it is I saw this survey about food and what natural means in relation to food. And so some people might think that the product of a particular process is natural, but the process that was used to produce it isn't. So if you look at something like flour, like wheat flour, people generally think, yeah, that's a natural food source because human beings have been making bread for thousands of years. But then if you look at some of the sort of commercial processes like bleaching and things like that, people are like, oh, that's not natural, but they'll still consider the end product, the flour, natural. So it's kind of interesting.
In food, it's really interesting how it's all confusing like that, because, you know, plants in their natural state, before we started domesticating and breeding them, they were, you know, largely inedible and tiny, and you could hardly work with them, and they tasted terrible. And so all the plants, pretty much all the plants that we grow commercially today are so much different than what would have been natural.
They're freaks.
Yeah, very much so.
They're freaks.
Mm.
Like when you walk through a supermarket and you see an ear of corn, it's a Frankenstein compared to, you know, the sort of ancient, sort of Mesoamerican maize type ancestor.
Mm, which had about one kernel of corn and it was about as hard as a rock, and I think it was purple.
Yeah, yeah.
So now we've got these big ears of corn that have thousands of kernels, and now they're yellow.
There's not generally much about modern farming or traditional production of food that is natural, that occurs in nature anymore. So that's,
I was trying to think about what in my life is natural.
Breathing, maybe.
Yeah, breathing, that's a good one. Yeah.
What about all the unnatural things you're breathing in?
Yeah, you've got to see.
Breathing this smooth aircon.
Like ingredient lists, I noticed, like, my wife buys lots of stuff from those hippie health food stores and stuff, and they're very big on branding, but it's clever branding because they've picked up on the fact that people want stuff that's perceived as natural in their products.
Yeah, so marketing has picked up on the fact that if you put natural on your logo or your packaging, it's some sort of marketing tactic too, to leverage people's sort of positive connotations of natural things.
But it's interesting when you read it because they've just been very clever about how they describe the ingredients they've got. Because if it's something a little bit scary sounding, like some polyethyl oxy glycol or something, they'll say it's from plant X, which they always give them the Latin name to make it sound a little bit more natural, because the Latin names are always a little bit more Mother Earthy than just saying, you know, tea tree or kiwi fruit. Yeah. So they're corn. very good at pitching the stuff they've got. But the chemical is the same whether it's produced in a factory to make that compound or extracted and purified from a plant. It is the same chemical if it's purified to the same degree of purity. So does the origin of what you're putting on your skin really matter as much as what the chemical actually is, whether or not it's from a plant or whether it's the byproduct of a petrochemical industry, for example?
But then, I mean, I have the issue I have with this whole idea is perhaps there is something real about the concerns about natural versus unnatural. So perhaps there is some truth in people wanting more traditional, more organic, more wholesome sort of foods. I'm going on foods because that's like sort of a lightning rod of natural versus unnatural, I think. So is there any truth to their fears? Is there any concern that perhaps the corn that we grow now, the potatoes that we eat now, the apples that we eat now, are they problematic? Are they unnatural? Are they not nutritious?
You mean in terms of like plant breeding or?
Yeah, or whatever is considered unnatural.
Yeah, I think the line can be split down there too, because an apple's not natural because we've bred it from something nature would never have made. But then if you take an extract out of apple and it's some chemical name, and then you can make that same chemical in the lab and give it to anyone and say, can you tell the difference? And you can't tell the difference. Then you can't really know if it's synthetic or made by a plant, even though it's the same chemical. But you have to wonder about, it's more about food production systems and things, I think, where what you're spraying on it and how you're looking after your orchard and management practices, rather than is the corn itself safe?
Yeah, you make a really good point. Like, I think you're right in a way. The less inputs you put on your crops in terms of pesticides and herbicides, surely the better for the environment and probably the better for us as well, because a lot of them have been linked to, not conclusively, but there's always been the doubts that some of these things.
But then you could use unnatural gene technologies to enable you to use almost no sprays, but that would be unnatural but much better for the environment.
Yeah. Does organic necessarily just relate to how a plant's grown, or does it relate to its DNA?
And I just want to address something that you said earlier about the chemical, if you sort of take it and you can't identify whether it's brought in from nature or not. If you get like a couple of teaspoons of sugar and you take it in and you want to eat it, your doctor will probably tell you that's probably a bad idea, this purified sugar. But then if you had exactly the same amount of sugar in a fruit,
distributed among the matrix of an apple,
it's not really looked at as being bad for you.
Yeah, definitely.
Is that real, or is that a perception? Is that a natural versus unnatural thing?
Well, I guess I was thinking if you'd just taken that sugar out of the apple so that it was also a teaspoon, and then you had a teaspoon of like synthetically made sugar, I wouldn't have thought there was much difference. But I think once you're putting it back into like a whole food, like an apple, where the plant's processed it and it's made it with all the other compounds that are in there, I think that's an important distinction, that where the apple would be better to have your teaspoon of sugar that way.
Right, so the processing, it's the processed part of the food that is probably the unnatural component that we're talking about.
Yeah, I think in that situation it would be.
In medicine there's a similar example where, you know, diabetics depend on insulin, and most insulin is produced through modified bacteria, but the insulin produced through modified bacteria versus unmodified methods, it's chemically identical. So it's not really the product that people find unnatural, it's the process of how it was arrived at, I think.
Used to be made in pig's spleens or something, didn't
yeah,
it?
That's yeah, that's natural to me.
Yeah.
I wouldn't mind chugging down a pig spleen. Of, yeah.
Rather than you'd have to inject a pig spleen.
Yeah, you couldn't chug it.
Yeah, it's true, yeah.
So that's quite an interesting sort of dive into the food. I was wondering if we could like bring it back out and then think about something like, is a like a bicycle isn't natural, I don't think most people would think, but it's also one of the most sustainable forms of transport.
Whoa, going meta on it. Yeah. A bicycle.
So,
but is sustainability natural?
Yeah, well, that's I guess that's the question. Is if you're trying to be, because normally you'd think natural sort of aligns with sustainability, but not so much for a bicycle. Does that make a bicycle more natural or less natural, or it doesn't affect it that way?
I think people mostly think about whether something's natural if it's something they're ingesting or a medicine they're being prescribed.
It does
or
seem
like
to have more sort of trigger points when it's going into your body.
A substance they're using to clean their clothes. You know, it's more like if it's going to be interacting with their body in some kind of way.
But then there's also the contrast, right? Like, so you're saying a bicycle on its own, it's really nothing, but in contrast to, let's say, a motor vehicle which burns fossil fuels, a bicycle is more natural. It has half as many wheels, it doesn't really use
doesn't burn too much
fossil fuels
to,
and doesn't emit, well, unless you're cycling it and you're emitting CO2. But it wouldn't, I mean, in most people's minds, I'd imagine that a bicycle would be more natural than a car.
Can I just jump in here?
Yeah.
Like every Sunday morning on Tamaki Drive, there's lots of middle-aged men and lycra cycling on Tamaki Drive.
You don't
Drive.
Think it's very
there
natural.
There is nothing natural about a man in his 50s on a racing bike standing outside of a cafe and lycra. It's, lycra is an unforgiving fabric.
Except natural can sometimes be ugly.
Whoa, you trying to spin it around on me now?
People can't just select how they look in lycra.
Don't wear it. There you go. Sorry, I've completely derailed your train of thought. Back to the bikes.
I can't get that image out of my mind now.
Yeah,
in lycra.
There's kind of a stunned silence around the table.
I got 2 points here. One's more of a question because, you know, antibiotic resistance in pathogens is natural, but perhaps we need to do something unnatural. You know, we have to like make them natural again, make them naturally not resistant to the bacteria. You know what I mean?
Well, like, so like if an asteroid was hurtling toward the Earth, would it be unnatural to divert its course?
it would be. Massively
I think you'd find that would be,
antibiotic resistance could have a similar effect.
Well, antibiotic resistance is all natural. Really.
So it's natural that it would evolve to deal with our antibiotics.
Yeah.
But we're going to have to probably naturally fix that.
It's natural only in the fact that they can do it, but the selection we're placing on them isn't natural. Like feeding cows antibiotics and creating, selecting for antibiotic resistant bacteria isn't natural. So the process is, like the way they develop immunity or resistance to antibiotics.
It's like we're making evolution do unnatural things because of where we're putting it.
Yep, exactly.
I don't know. I like my antibiotic burgers.
Yeah. Yeah,
makes
so,
you healthy.
Yeah,
that's why you never get sick, Jay.
Exactly, and I stay out of the cold.
Yeah,
stay inside.
What if we turned a dog back into a wolf? Would that be natural?
Is this part of a dream sequence?
Yeah, yeah,
these questions are all random.
I realized once we started this question that I can just bring my dream book and just ask all my dreams, and then we could figure it out because it's just it's the same stuff.
Haven't they effectively done that with wheat, or they're trying to do that with wheat,
like rewild
de-domestication? It's an actual science technique that they're trying to do to regain characteristics of these wild grasses that wheat lacks.
So we'd end up with a natural product, but the process would be unnatural? Is that where you think the line would fall? That's quite interesting.
Sorry, meta on meta.
Yeah. No, I had a dog that was very de-domesticated once.
That's just poorly trained.
Yeah, we're literally untrainable dog. Swear to God, it must have been de-domesticated by somebody before I got it. Yeah, anyway.
I don't know. I'm a huge fan of wolves, so...
It was effectively a wolf, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't met one, so that's probably why.
You got it imported from some, like, reserve somewhere, some grey wolf you didn't realise? It was actually your wolf. Dog,
yeah. Or just poor training. Come on, admit it.
It's just poor training, yeah.
I think I'd prefer to see existing wolves being conserved rather than all of this effort being put into, like, you know, bringing some ancient wolf ancestor back.
I think wolves are doing pretty well, actually.
Oh, not in some areas.
I heard they're coming back generally.
I heard they're not.
Okay.
I heard Tom's facts.
I heard the wolves were coming back, or at least the grey wolf.
Oh yeah, they're being managed right now in
America and stuff.
Yeah, exactly. But I think the problem that Tom's talking about is de-extinction, right? So yeah, I'm not a huge fan of that either.
What about for the moor?
It had its time.
It only had its time till we killed it. Yeah. Like lots of species that have died recently. We got the West African black rhino a couple of weeks ago, I think.
If you bring the moor back, it's always going to be looking over its shoulder for the harst eagle.
So we'll have to bring that back too. And then that sort of preyed on bipedal animals that were like 1.5 meters tall, which includes us.
Yeah. And if we don't bring extinct animals back, there's no Jurassic Park trilogy.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah. Sam Neill doesn't have a career.
Oh, and man.
The whole New Zealand film industry changes overnight.
So changed my mind.
You want to think a little bit more, Jay, to be honest.
And then Richard Attenborough won't ever be able to say that he spared no expense.
Again, that's just another good reason.
De-extinction's an interesting one.
Cross that one off.
That would probably fall under unnatural, I guess.
Bringing back extinct species.
Probably hasn't happened naturally too many times. Although I remember we spoke once about somebody who found some yeast fossilized in some amber, and it was some number of millions of years old, 250 million years maybe. And they revived the yeast cell and then made beer out of it. So it was like a Jurassic Park beer.
It was still alive.
They revived the cell, yeah.
Count on human beings seeing yeast and thinking, yep, that's great beer right there. You bring back the moa, KFC's like, yep, perfect. That's what we needed. Extra large chicken drumsticks.
Yeah, well, that would be good.
I mean, that'll be the business case to bring them back, is that they'll be farmed.
Of course.
Yeah.
You know, why else would they pour all the money in?
Yeah.
You should be a business manager, Jay. You're wasted in science.
I know.
The de-extinction business manager.
Yeah, you got
the giant drumsticks.
This excellent salary that I get as a scientist, you know.
It's keeping you there.
It's what keeps me here.
Okay, fair enough.
All right, well, that's awesome. I think we covered that pretty well, and we've got a topic for next time about learning about how wolves are doing.
So that's the baseline for pretty well, is it?
that we're doing learning about wolves, yeah. I think so. That could be a good baseline.
Pixar, it didn't happen, bro.
All right, I'll have to come back with some data on that.
I'll have to cherry pick some.
Yeah,
some
you'll have to find something that backs up yours.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Just Google till you find an opinion that agrees with yours.
Yeah, that's what I always do.
All right, so we'll wrap it up there. So thank you very much, Jay and Tom and Andrew, for your time in our SciFri session. And we'll see you in an upcoming Friday where we can have another go at a different topic.
So thanks, Blue.
Cheers.
Thank you.
And thanks to our listeners. Please get in touch at Plant and Food across social media with any suggestions and future topics you'd like to hear discussed. Don't forget to subscribe, rate, and review our podcast on iTunes or your favorite podcast provider.
The views or opinions expressed in this podcast are of the hosts or guests only. They do not necessarily represent the views or opinions of Plant and Food Research.